I've spent the last 4 videos teaching you everything there is to know about wire size, wire insulation, wire ampacities, and more. But what happens when you make poor wire choices? Common wire mistakes and how to avoid them is exactly what we're going to be covering here in lesson number 5 of this wire basics playlist. My name is Nate, and welcome to the EXPLORIST Life Mobile, Marine, and Off-Grid Electrical Academy. Now, before we get started, I put some important information about this academy, some additional resources, and some prerequisite information related to this video down in the pinned comment below. So be sure to scroll down and check it out. Instead of bigger wires, can I just use multiple smaller wires? We see this a lot with big inverters. Some inverter manufacturers supply a dual wire with a single lug on each end instead of a single wire. And if there's enough combined copper inside of both wires added together to carry the power, there's nothing really wrong with this, but it does limit us on fusing, and here's why. When you have a dual wire situation like that, the fuse protecting those dual wires cannot be larger than is acceptable for one of these single wires. Now here's a specific example. In this wiring diagram directly from Victron, they have 2 wires powering a single multi-plus 3 kVA 12 volt inverter charger. And those 2 wires are protected by a single 400 amp fuse. Now, although they don't necessarily list their wire size directly on the diagram, if we hop over into the user manual for that multi-plus, we can see that they have 50 millimeters squared spec'd out for the shorter runs, which is equivalent to 1 gauge wire for those of us here in the US. High quality 1 gauge wire with 105 degree insulation is rated for 245 amps when installed outside of an engine space without any additional derating factors. ABYC E11.10.1.5.2 says that each fuse or trip-free circuit breaker shall be rated in accordance with E11.10.1.3 and E11.10.1.4 and shall not exceed 150% of the conductor capacities in tables 4A through 4B. This means that the max fuse size that can protect 1 gauge wire is 245 amps times 1.5 equals 367 amps. So a single 400 amp fuse protecting dual 1 gauge wire is actually not allowed per the ABYC. This is why you see us here at EXPLORIST Life actually going against manufacturers' recommendations in this case, in our kits and diagrams, and instead specking out single 4-aught wire, aka 107 millimeter squared wire, rated to 445 amps to cover the 100 millimeter squared equivalent of dual 1 gauge or 50 millimeter squared wire. Can I just use wire from my local hardware store? Now, if you take into account everything I've taught you over the last 4 videos of this academy regarding insulation types, wire ampacities, and derating factors, you technically could do that, but you're really going to hate that decision when you go to wire batteries together or wire an inverter with big 4-aught THHN wire that bends about as well as rebar. 4-aught battery wire like we sell in our store is rarely sold at standard home improvement stores, but is incredibly flexible and easy to work with in tight quarters like all of you watching this video will be working in. Can I use 4 gauge wire instead of 4-aught wire since it's so much cheaper? So if something requires 4-aught wire, you can't simply sub in 4 gauge wire. Remember back from lesson 3.3 of this academy, that 4-aught wire is nearly 4 times larger than 4 gauge wire, which is also why it's so expensive. Remember from lesson 3.3, that wire gets bigger as the wire gauge gets smaller, but only until we get to 0 gauge, where the wire then gets bigger as we start adding zeros. Confusing, I know, but go back to lesson 3.3 if you need a refresher on that one. Can I just oversize my wires to be safe? Actually, yes, but only to a degree. And you still have to do the math behind the decision to make sure that oversizing is actually an appropriate wire size. A specific example here is actually in the wiring kits that we sell at shop.exploris.life. Now you'll notice on both our 50 amp and 30 amp charge controller wiring kits, they both use 6 gauge wire. The 6-gauge wire math checks out for both applications, but the max terminal size on the Victron Smart Solar MPPT 150 and 130, they're both 6-gauge. So we just consolidate wire sizes on those so that they work for as wide of a customer base as possible. Upsizing further than 6-gauge for either of these kits would result in wire not fitting into the terminal of the device, which opens a whole new can of worms. So yes, oversizing wire can be a good idea, but only if you do it strategically and have some thought and justification behind it. Wire is expensive. Can I just use smaller wire? Now we can talk about tables and ratings and blah, blah, blah all day, but I've got some 16-gauge wire and a 800-watt inverter and a thermal camera. And I think you know where this is going. A quick rundown of what we have here. We have two 100 amp hour battle-borne lithium batteries up through a Blue Sea safety hub with proper breakers on the positive side. This breaker's not really appropriate for this wire, but that wire is not appropriate for this inverter. So moving on, we've got a shunt over on this side that is sending its data to this eChrono GX that is telling us just how much power is coming out of the batteries at any given time, which is telling us how much power this inverter is pulling. So we have our Victron Phoenix 12-volt, 800-volt amp inverter. We'll just call it an 800-watt inverter for simplifying this, this discussion. And it is being fed through two 16-gauge wires that are rated for 25 amps max, and those are high quality wires, so this is going to be showing the effect of flowing too many amps through too small of high quality wires. Sort of anticipations here are this is, you know, an 800 watt inverter divided by 12 volts, that's somewhere in the ballpark of 66 amps, and so that's like 2.5 times the amount of power that's rated to flow through those wires. So we should see some significant heating. We've got this little micro space heater over here that is connected to the back of the Phoenix 12800 inverter. On low, we were registering it pulling about 650 to 700 watts, somewhere in that range, but I'll be able to monitor it there. All of this is being monitored through this thermal camera that's right up here that I'm going to give you a rundown of what we're looking for on that. A quick rundown of what we're seeing on our thermal camera. So we have our FLIR thermal camera here connected to our phone, and we have two markers here. This is the only one you need to pay attention to because it's directly on the positive wire of that. So this is telling you what the temperature is on that wire. In the event that the wires move whenever we turn the space heater on, it's important to look up here at this range at the top. We've got 65 degrees on the low end and 100 degrees on the high end. This is telling us the coldest part of the entire frame and the hottest part of the entire frame. Currently, 100 degrees is on that eChrono GX touchscreen because it's kind of a little computer and it's operating, but you know, it's warm, but it's not hot. Pretty to be expected. So as these wires heat up, we should see this number change fairly dramatically. Steph is going to be behind this thermal camera, kind of letting me know what the temperatures are while I'm messing with everything over here on the backside. Let's get started. Currently the inverter is on, the space heater is off, and we are flowing 1.2 amps through the batteries to the inverter just in standby power. Steph, are the wires showing any kind of heat at the moment?
Nope, 70 degrees.
70 degrees, no heat flowing, because that's pretty expected, because those wires are going to easily flow 1.2 amps it takes to run standby power on the inverter. So I am going to turn this on, turn the space heater on, and then turn it to low immediately so we don't try not to overload the inverter. Steph is going to let me know what the temperatures are as the amps start to climb. So, here we go, I'm nervous. Space heater on, mode to low. We are now flowing 440 watts, 82 amps, 1200 watts. That's really high, I don't know why it's that high. Temperatures?
We're at 130.
130,
140.
150, 1,000 watts,
170,
170, and our inverter just shut off. We overloaded the inverter because that space heater was a little too powerful, I suppose. What's our temperatures at the moment?
213.
And those, very hot. You only touch them for a couple seconds. Yeah, seemed like it jumped up to like 1,000 watts, which is a little more than what we anticipated on that. Overloaded the inverter. It's telling me it's ready again. Let's just fire it back up. Good. Okay, space heater is back on, back up to 1,200 watts. What kind of temperatures are we getting?
190,
200. We're at just shy of 80 amps. Temperatures,
240.
And
260, 280.
Okay.
Smoking.
All right, cool. That's smoking. We got some pretty good blistering of the wires there, and they're pretty much, pretty messed up at this point. So that's kind of the effect of flowing too much power through these wires. And realistically, that's why you shouldn't undersize your wires. You know, we were at about 100 amps coming through those wires from what we observed through the eChrono. And so that's four times as much power as is rated to flow through those wires. Now, would those wires combust? Eventually, maybe. But I think that those are going to get so hot that they're more likely going to catch other things on fire around them. And if that insulation melts all the way off of the wire, could expose the copper, which could be direct shorts, which could be even more heat, even more catastrophic failure. So I hope that provided a little bit of insight as to why you shouldn't oversize or undersize your wires. I hope this helps provide some insight into common problems we see surrounding improper wire choices. And now it is worth mentioning that the system kits and diagrams that we sell in our store over at shop.exploris.life have all the proper wire sizes and types included or figured out for you. Now, if the thought of messing up wire sizes or types scares you away from your next electrical project, we now offer installation services, and I'll put a link to our store and our installation services below. We're going to be referring to wire sizes and types throughout the rest of this academy, so be sure to bookmark this video for future reference and come back to it if you need a refresher. Now that you know everything there is to know about wire sizes and types, it's time for the grand finale of our wire basics playlist, so I can tie everything together and teach you step by step how to choose proper wires and sizes with some real life examples. So click up here to watch, and I'll see you over there. Instead of bigger wires, can I just use smaller wires? Oh, wait.
No.
What? Guess so. You can do whatever you want, I guess. You technically could do that, but you're really going to hate yourself
We're just gonna hate
in general.